Once again, special thanks to Lance for giving us permission, and congratulations on your recent award for Nightmare. Okay, so the logline, guys, goes like this. Having trouble with orc basilisk or a gargoyle? Maybe harpies are harassing you and your neighbors. No matter what your dilemma, Monster Investigations is there to help. Our team is fast, thorough, and professional, and will quickly solve any problem for you. Just call 1-838-MONSTER. That's 666-7837. Or visit us at monsterinvestigations.net for your free evaluation. And this is going to be a dramedy of fantasy, and it is supernatural.
Dude, he didn't register monsterinvestigations.net.
Actually, he was telling me that he did.
Oh, you know what? It must be registered. It's just a blank page. Because I guess maybe it would have gone to someone offering to sell the IP.
Yeah, yeah. No, he's got it. Yeah, because okay. He told me. I love that you checked that.
Instantly.
All right, so why don't we go ahead and get started, guys? I'm going to run downstairs real quick as Majin starts and grab a power charger real quick.
He's actually grabbing his props.
It's the lotion and the bath. As it gets the hose again.
I can't believe he just left us like that.
How dare he?
Quick, let's all join Smish's page and I'll host her.
Oh yeah, that would be like such an awesome prank, like a reverse host.
He comes back, where is everybody? We're like on a different Discord.
Yeah. It's private. He's not allowed in. I can do that.
Okay, I'm back.
Oh, hey, we're just talking about you.
I know, I heard the entire time. Okay, and we can start whatever. So let me just go ahead and post the readers once more.
I preferred being told exactly, like, start now, and I will begin. Whenever, like, I could be whenever.
I want to hear a gunshot go off.
So, just tell us action.
And action.
Monster Investigations, written by Lance Wayne. Monsterinvestigations.net pending. Teaser, super. Los Padres National Forest, Santa Barbara, California. Exterior, Ponderosa Hotel, night. Nestled amongst the almost 3,000 square miles of forest, the Ponderosa Hotel looks brand new. The big log cabin-type building is three stories with 18 guest rooms. In the parking lot are commercial vans and trucks for electricians, plumbers, carpenters, drywallers, etc. A reopens this Memorial Day banger hangs at the entrance. Interior Ponderosa Hotel banquet room. Numbering about 50, the workers and their families are eating, drinking, and having a good time. There's plenty of food at the banquet tables, and a DJ plays the hits. The owners are David and Hannah Bowman, in their 40s. As David mingles, he spots Hannah come in from a door off to the side. Hannah gives him the smallest of nods. Suspicious. David goes to the DJ stand, grabs the mic. As he taps it to get everyone's attention, is this thing on? The DJ turns off the music and everyone faces him.
I'd just like to make a quick toast to thank everyone for your hard work over the last year. After the tragic events the previous owners faced, Hannah and I knew restoring the Ponderosa.
A large gust of wind billows the curtains and blows through the crowd. Everyone looks over.
Could someone please shut that window?
A server standing close by moves the curtains aside, but the window's already shut. Confused, the server looks at David.
It is closed, sir.
The crowd's nervous and everyone looks around. A large punch bowl begins to levitate, then floats over the crowd. As it hovers over a lady holding a red plastic cup, the ghost of a clown materializes, smiles at her.
Let me top off the drink for you, m'lady.
Ghost clown dumps the entire bowl of punch on the woman's head and starts laughing. Ghost clown, laughing. The crowd panics as they head for the main door. A big poof of smoke stops them. As the smoke quickly dissipates, the ghost of a magician materializes, wearing a tux, top hat, and cape.
Where are you going? You haven't even met Mr. Fluffies!
As ghost magician bows, he removes his top hat. He reaches inside, pulls out a rabbit, and flings it in the air. As the rabbit flies across the room, it grows to 10 feet tall. Hops around, it crashes into things, pushing people around. The crowd freaks out, scrambles away. The ghost clown flies to the banquet table, grabs all kinds of food, and starts flinging it to the crowd.
Second course, now served!
Ghost clown grabs a handful of bean casserole and nails a 10-year-old boy in the face with it.
Don't forget your vegetables!
He grabs something else, flies to the boy.
And if you eat all your vegetables, you'll get dessert.
Ghost clown slams a piece of pie down on the boy's head. He sticks a finger in it, tastes it.
Mmm, peach cobbler. Just like Gammy used to make. Rest her wicked soul.
During the chaos, multiple people have pulled out their smartphones to record everything. Across the room, Ghost Magician now has a deck of cards. He fans them out and looks at a man running by.
You! Pick a card!
Man keeps running.
Or not. You! Pick a card!
Woman doesn't even look at him.
What am I, invisible? Nope. Fine. I'll pick all of them.
The cards crackle with electricity. He starts flicking them at people. When the card hits a person, it's like they're being tasered. They spasm and crumple to the ground. Ghost clown's now at the DJ stand with headphones on. He cranks up Peter Gabriel's Shock the Monkey and starts shaking his ass. David and Hannah are hiding under a table, watching everything. They each glance up at surveillance cameras mounted in the corners of the room. They look to each other and grin. End of teaser. Act 1. Interior lobby of the Santiago Schwartz office. Day. Emma, the receptionist, 25 Paris Hilton wannabe, is gossiping on her smartphone. Waiting in the lobby are Bryce Barnes, 26, 5'7, thin, nerdy, think Christopher Mintz-Plasse, is talking on his smartphone about Lamborghinis, but he's really trying to impress Emma, who looks at him finally. Bryce gives her a cheesy smile and a wink. Emma just looks away. One-on-one with Bryce in the hallway. One-on-ones are quick cutaways for characters' thoughts and input. Bryce is being filmed by cameraman Mahisa, 29, in view.
Hello, my name's Bryce Barnes. I'm 26 and the founder, CEO, and head honcho of this little endeavor we like to call Monster Investigations. I was able to fund our venture after selling my Find Your Golf Ball app for $187 million. But first, I spent a year traveling the world with dozens of beautiful women.
Bryce leans in, puts his hand to his mouth like he's telling a secret.
Most of them supermodels that I left, brokenhearted, but players gotta play. Am I right? Alright. Tricky question. I'm always right. Afterwards, I decided it was time to create something new, something to help people in need. Thus, Monster Investigations was born. For the people, for their safety, for their peace of mind.
Bryce is truly a likable guy. He's just a bit delusional about his appearance and his game. Interior lobby of Santiago Schwartz's office. Day. Zoe ZZ Jimenez, 27, 5'2", Hispanic, tosses up a ball of fire and catches it. She gets bored, disappears. She looks at the large fish tank, grins. She points at a hand and at it She points her hand at it. The water inside begins to swirl. One-on-one with ZZ in the hallway. Again, these films. ZZ has a pretty thick accent.
Hola. I mean, hello. I'm Zoe Jimenez, but everyone calls me ZZ.
Is that your favorite band?
Band?
ZZ Top, the blues rock band from Texas?
I'm not really familiar with American music. ZZ is from my name, Zoe Jimenez.
Oh, yeah. That makes sense.
Yes. I'm 27. I recently moved here from Toluca, Mexico. And I'm a bruja, known in America as witch. I've mastered control of the four elements. I know 37 spells so far, and I'm kinda psychic. But I can't control that yet.
That was premature.
Interior, lobby of Santiago Schwartz's office. Day, Vartful, 34, a demon, 6'7", dark red.
Sorry, you guys,
horns,
if you heard that.
All muscles. Think Hellblade. He's looking at a children's book, concentrating extremely hard. He's truly baffled.
There is no way Wano was in this picture.
Wow. Jane Doe, 18, ghost, 5'6".
Pants, you fucking nerd.
Died in 1978, so she's stuck wearing 70s hair and clothes. Think Farrah Fawcett watches a how-to makeup video on her smartphone. Happy with what she sees, she leans over and shows ZZ.
What do you think of this one?
Video's a tutorial for Dia de los Muertos, makeup, the Day of the Dead.
That's cool.
I was thinking instead of red, we could do blue. That'd go perfect with the new blouse you just got. Your black leather pants and biker boots. Then we pull your hair back, add a blue rose, and c'est parfait.
I'm like your Mexican Barbie doll.
That's true. Vartul, what do you think?
Jane turns the phone to Vartul, startled by the skeleton makeup. Vartul jumps back.
Ah, I mean, that's red? People still say red, right?
No, but I don't think anyone's going to argue with you.
I would.
ZZ grins, holds up her hand as it engulfs in flames. Vartul grins, opens his mouth, and breathes fire. Emma notices. She yells at him.
Oh my god, you two, stop that! You're gonna set off the fire alarm! God.
Jane's annoyed that her friends got yelled at. She points at the smoke detector and yells back at them.
Hey, Bubbles, that is a smoke detector. Something has to be on fire before...
The office door opens. Exiting are four individuals, another monster investigations type team. A handsome man, a male genie, a female cyborg, half human, half robot. Come on, that's what cyborg means. And a 7-foot orc, age question mark. When Mahisa sees the genie, she immediately turns to the camera so he can't see her face. Bryce is upset with seeing some competition. A slow-mo of each team checking out its counterpart. Bryce and a handsome man look at each other. ZZ and Genie share a glance. Jane, female cyborg, do up and downs. Vartul flexes his muscles. Orc rolls his eyes. After the other team exits, Emma addresses our team.
Mr. Schwartz will, like, see you now?
Everyone heads into the office, but Jane hangs back to talk to Emma, who she's still mad at.
If you ever disrespect my friends again...
Jane looks at Emma's office supplies cup holder, sees a pair of scissors. The scissors fly out of the cup. One of Jane's powers is telekinesis, by the way. They're just inches from Emma's hair and are opening and closing.
I'll give you a Vin Diesel.
Jane flicks her hands up. The scissors fly and stick to the ceiling. Jane enters the office and closes the door. Emma looks up, also sticking in the ceiling are numerous pens, pencils, a letter opener, a stapler, red stapler.
Freaking ghost. So temperamental.
And the one-on-one with Jane in the hallway.
Hi, my name's Jane Doe. Jane Doe, because I don't remember who I am. Or was, I guess. I'm 18, kinda. As you can tell by this lovely haircut and these awesome clothes, I died in the 70s. 1978, to be exact, which means I was born in 1960. So technically, I'm 56. though sometimes it feels like I'm 156.
Interior, Santiago Schwartz's office. Santiago Schwartz, 53, eternally jovial, greets the team. The office is overloaded with everything golf. Posters, knickknacks, clock, golf club hands, putting practice, green, putting practice, bag, clubs, paperweight, clamps, etc.
Monster Investigations, my favorite soon-to-be famous clients. How are we doing today?
What the heck, Santiago? You're representing another team?
Bryce, come on, Pookie. Agents have any number of clients in the same field. I represent reality TV stars, or in your case, up-and-coming reality TV stars. Ever since the Creature Crew hit rating gold, times have been forming right and left. But don't worry about those guys. They got nothing on you. Where's Doc?
He's getting our license.
Santiago gives him a look.
Seriously? How'd you get to the top of the waiting list?
He's got a buddy on the inside.
You know, you can't take any cases without a license. And you especially get your own TV show without one. You can't... Blah.
Hey, if Doc says he's gonna get one, I trust him.
Bartool's looking at all the gold stuff.
You must really like tennis, huh?
Good one, Bartool. So, besides being Team Muscle, you want to be Team Comedian too? Fail?
Hell yeah. Is that really an option? Because I was known as Rodney Dangerfield of level 3.
Level 3?
My department in hell, level 3, section 62, is where people get tortured for talking too loud on their cell phones.
On a one-on-one with Bartool in the hallway.
What's up? I'm Bartool, demon from hell. I'm Team Muscle and also Team Comedian, which is amazing since I'm definitely the funniest demon you'll ever meet.
Are you on leave from hell or something?
Solid question. I actually got kicked out. Poor job performance. I really was known as the Rodney Dangerfield level 3, but mostly because no one respected me.
Alright, after this.
Interior.
No, sir. I was thinking about running.
Sharp man! You had your mic on.
Sorry.
Thought someone was talking to us. Interior, Santiago Schwartz's office. Mahisa films everything. Santiago's now sitting behind his desk. He hands Bryce 4 clipboards of paperwork.
Here are your contracts. Please sign those. And you can give Doc his when you see him next.
Bryce passes ZZ, Jane, and Bartool the clipboards and contracts.
And here's a dozen release forms. Just make more copies as you need them. Remember, you can't use footage of anyone unless they've signed the release forms. You don't want to get sued for someone using someone's likeness without their consent.
Bryce quickly signs his contract and hands it back to Santiago.
So, what kind of case you got for us?
Bryce, I just told you, you can't take...
We'll have the license today, I promise.
Santiago shakes his head no.
You know, I have to have a copy on file before I can send you out. I'm sorry, but I can't. I won't risk it. You gotta get that license. I got you a case. Then we can put a demo reel together and send it out to the networks.
Defeated, Bryce slumps in his chair and frowns. Exterior, Monster Investigations Headquarters, MIHQ, during the day. The team's arriving in a black Mercedes-Benz Sprinter van with cool Monster Investigations logo on the side. Headquarters is a recently redesigned YMCA. Bryce has spent big money to make it exceptionally nice. In front, a huge monster investigation sign is being raised by a boom lift. In the Mercedes-Benz Sprinter, the team's checking out the workers installing the new sign.
Sweet! Our sign's here.
Outside MIHQ, as the team exits the Sprinter, operator controlling the boom lift is startled by Vertul. He accidentally pulls a lever, causing the sign to plummet towards the ground. Jane thinks fast. She points a hand at the sign, stopping it with her telekinesis. Just inches from the ground, she raises it back up onto the boom.
Nice catch.
The operator yells.
Thanks, Farah. I owe you a beer, sexy.
Annoyed, Jane rolls her eyes and shakes her head.
Farah Fawcett? Real original. Douche.
ZC glares at the operator, says a spell in Spanish, and points above him. A little dark storm cloud appears and unleashes an ungodly amount of rain on him.
Don't mess with Texas.
As everyone enters the building...
Don't mess with Texas?
Yeah. Sorry, not sure where that came from.
In MIHQ, in the lobby, this place is incredible, beautiful, and opulent. One thing Bryce certainly splurges on is image. At the reception desk is Anna Lynn, 35, black, full-figured, think Yvette Nicole Brown, and she's our version of the Bride of Frankenstein. Anna Lynn has a white left arm, a light brown right hand, a tan right leg, and a blue left eye. Her hair is reverse of the original bride. It's white with black streaks. The large smart TV displays multiple channels, E! News, TMZ, The Insider, Access Hollywood, etc., and the tables in the waiting room are covered with magazines, Entertainment, People, US Weekly. Anna Lynn's a celebrity junkie. Jane and ZZ smile, wave at Anna Lynn, and head their own ways. Vertul approaches her desk as Bryce jumps on a hoverboard that was parked by the front of her.
Is Doc here?
Yeah, he's downstairs. Hey,
Did he get our license?
I don't know. I think he's been in his lab all day, but I've got good news.
Bryce speeds his hoverboard towards the elevator.
Back in a minute!
It's really good news. Great news. Spectacular.
Annalyn, I'll be back in a...
I got us a case.
Bryce slams on the brakes, looks back at Annalyn, who smiles. One-on-one with Annalyn in reception, Mahisa films. Annalyn sits at her desk, which has dozens of deer figurines on it.
Hey, y'all. I'm Annalyn. Sorry. I'm Anna Lynn Hutchison, the office manager, and soon to be the team manager.
Team manager?
I told Bryce from the beginning he doesn't need an agent. I can do it. Now I hear Santiago's representing another team, and he won't give us a case. We don't need him. I lost my place, sorry.
We can
stay within our family, get it done ourselves.
Hisa lowers the camera, focuses in on all the deer.
Can you tell us about your love for deers? Deer?
I think it's deer. Pretty sure it's like fish. And it's not my love, it's Claire's.
Annalyn raises her white left arm.
That's what I call this arm.
Oh. Why Claire?
Claire's about as wide as you can get. How many black Claires you know?
I can't say I...
Exactly. Anyway, I'm right-handed, yet it's my left arm that's obsessed with these things. I mean, they're okay, I guess, but...
Annalyn's white arm rearranges a figurine. She grins. In the MIHQ conference room, the team watches the 70-inch smart TV that Annalyn controls with her iPad. She hits play in the YouTube videos of the Ponderosa Hotel haunting again.
This happened two nights ago at the Ponderosa Hotel, which is up in Santa Barbara. But to be more accurate, it's really in the middle of the Los Padres National Forest.
The team's shocked and excited by the clown and magician.
Is that a party?
Yep. It was a reopening soon type of party for all the construction workers and their families. I did a bit of research. Turns out almost 3 years ago, about half the place burned down during a kid's birthday party. They knew it was arson, but there was never an arrest. They couldn't ID a suspect. And the clown and the magician were killed in the fire? Yes, along with 8 others. Sorry.
That was brilliant.
Sorry, guys. I was ignoring chat, so I wouldn't laugh, so then I fucked up, sorry. Yes, along with 8 others. The old owner sold the place and then just disappeared. The new owner spent the last year getting it back into shape. Their grand reopening is supposed to be this Memorial Day.
How'd you guess the job?
I called them, offered our services. Like any good manager would do. Shut up. Like any good manager would do, Bryce. They're expecting us tonight. I already Googled it. The hotel's about 3 hours. So, we better leave soon.
Bryce is staring intently at the footage.
What about?
Stop!
I barely started.
The video! Stop the video!
Bryce stands, takes the iPad from Anna Lynn. He rewinds its slow-mos and zooms into something small running under the table. It's a creepy-looking creature, barely 2 feet tall. But the zoom-in and motion blur make it difficult to discern.
What's that thing?
Part of my nightmare tonight.
Is it miniature, Arnie?
Reggie, 25, black, 6-foot, athletic, GQ model material, think Tyson Beckford, that's obscure, walks in. He's wearing an Obi-Wan Kenobi clothes robe, but from the neck up, he's all Klingon.
Hey guys, sorry I'm late. The confer...
Reggie, what? What are you wearing this time?
Obviously, he's Obi-Wan Worf.
Jane gets up, inspects Reggie's makeup.
Makeup still looks good. J'aime ça.
Thanks to you, everyone. Whoa. That's a scout troll.
I thought trolls were big. Like giants.
They come in all sizes, from teeny-weeny up to ginormous. I think the record's 4.6 feet tall. Where is that?
It's at a hotel. In Los Padres National Forest.
I've never heard of any trolls up there, but that is a huge forest, and scouts can travel hundreds of miles a day.
Those little things?
They're really fast. This might only be the second or third time one's ever been caught on film.
What do you think it's doing at the party?
Scout trolls have 2 main objectives. Find food, find their enemies, and if they're lucky, well, it's the same thing.
They eat their enemies?
Reggie nods. Bryce is pumped, ready to go.
Okay, everyone. Get ready. We leave in 10 minutes.
I'll never be able to get out of this makeup and change that fast.
Well, you'll have to go like that.
Nice.
What about dinner? We haven't eaten yet? I'm not taking time to eat, man.
We'll get out LA first, then grab something on the way.
I just made some cupcakes and brownies. You can snack on those.
Artul approaches Annalyn. Bryce is on her other side.
Great find, Annalyn.
You know how much I love your baked goods.
Both kiss Annalyn on each cheek.
Oh.
Annalyn smiles as Bryce is about to exit the conference room.
Bryce, team manager?
Exasperated, Bryce looks up. He's tired of this conversation.
Annalyn, you're already our manager.
Office manager, big deal. I want to represent the team. Obviously, I can get us work when Santiago would rather have you sitting on the sideline polishing your knob. I can do the job.
Bryce thinks for a couple seconds.
Okay, how about this? When we're done editing tonight's footage, I'll give you the same demo reel I'll give Santiago. If you get us a show first on a major network, you're in. Santiago's out.
Annalyn's elated. She puts her hand out.
Deal.
But as they shake hands, Bryce realizes something.
Oh, crap. Our license.
Bryce rushes out. End of Act 1. Act 2. Interior MIHQ elevator. Moments later, Bryce is on his hoverboard going down to the basement. Ding! In the basement, Bryce rolls to a door that has a cool surfboard decal on it. Doc's lab. Like Santiago's office was ODing on golf stuff, Doc's large and luxurious lab is all surfing stuff. But it also has all the latest and greatest science equipment. This place is so cool. Dr. Shigeo, Doc Inomoto, Asian 23, 5'9", is our version of the mad scientist. His hair is bleach blonde and in a big, messy hipster pompadour. He's currently working a work table, fine-tuning some funky-looking Google-type glasses. As Bryce rolls towards him, he sees off to the side a couple goblins, a 3'5" female and a 3'7" male, sitting on a couch, loudly playing Call of Duty on a big-screen TV. Bryce stops. Doc taps his shoulder, startling him.
Doc!
Doc jumps, turns to Bryce. Doc's wearing custom goggles that emit a blue fluorescent light, making his eyes appear neon. On a one-on-one with Doc, Reggie films this time, and he says not there.
Yo, I'm Dr. Shigeo Inomoto, otherwise known as Doc. I'm 23, and I recently graduated from MIT with a bunch of PhDs in science and stuff. I'm the team...
Don't you want to mention what your degrees are in?
Nah, not really. I know I should feel proud, and I do, but I don't know. The super smart Asian dude? Kind of cliche, ain't it?
Doc, you've got 6 PhDs. That's a really impressive accomplishment. Nothing wrong with a little bragging.
Thanks, bro. I appreciate that, but I'll pass. Anywho, I'm the team's forensics and gadgets guy, and man oh man, have I come up with some cool stuff.
Doc smiles as he holds up a funky-looking futuristic rifle and a funky-looking futuristic handgun.
Whoa.
Exactly.
In Doc's lab, Bryce points to the goblins.
Who are they?
Hey, turn it down. We got company.
The goblins hit pause, waddle over to Bryce and Doc. These two will have minions feel to them and will talk in a gibberish language only Doc can understand. Doc introduces the female, who's wearing about 2 pounds of gaudy makeup, then the male.
This is Trixie, Peanut Butter the Fifth, and Ninja Golden Swagger.
Those are great names. Bryce gives Doc a what-the-fuck look. Doc shrugs.
I let them pick their own names, but you can just call them Trixie and Ninja.
Trixie smiles, bats her eyelashes at Bryce.
And... you can call Trixie tonight. She's a bit of a... free spirit? That's one way to put it.
Okay, next obvious question. Why are they here?
Bruh, I told you getting to the front of the line for our license was gonna cost ya.
I thought you meant money.
Yeah, well, so did I. But that wasn't on the table. This was.
Doc motions to Trixie and Ninja.
So, what you're their new dad?
Nah, it's just until their new home opens.
Now Trixie and Ninja give Doc a WTF look.
weird.
I didn't say zoo. I said new home. Go back to your video game.
As they head back, Trixie shakes her head, sticks her tongue out at Doc while Ninja gives him the up yours arm gesture. It's actually an FU arm gesture. Doc pulls two packs of Starburst out of his lab coat and tosses them at Trixie and Ninja.
Cheer up! It's sugar rush time!
Trixie and Ninja are instantly giddy and dig into their treats.
So, the license, you got it?
Yeah, sorta, yeah. It's in the mail. Noriko said she'd send it out today.
Bryce is once again exasperated.
Why didn't you pick it up? We got a case tonight!
You told me to work on these! You said, get them ready ASAP, dude!
Bryce figures it out.
Okay, if she's sending it out tonight, that means we're officially licensed as of today, right?
Right!
So we can take the case tonight, right?
Right?
Okay, back up. We leave in 8 minutes.
Bryce rolls back to the door.
Where are we going?
Las Patuas National Forest.
Ninja's excited. He looks at Doc.
Sure, we might run into some unicorns up there. They're probably hanging out with the leprechauns.
In the tech room, as Reggie enters, he starts recording. But he's just packing up equipment, EVP recorders, EMF meters, FLIR cameras, etc.
Hey, Mahisa, time for your one-on-one.
Mahisa, wearing an Iron Maiden t-shirt, is reluctant.
Oh, Reggie, I don't want to do a one-on-one. I'm just a camera woman.
We're part of the team, Mahisa. Besides, Bryce said we have to, so let's just get it over with.
Mahisa gives in, faces the camera. Reggie gives her a 3, 2, 1 finger countdown, and go.
I'm Mahisa Malireddy. I'm 29 and from Jakarand, India. I graduated from the Indian Institute of Technology, Bombay, and have a degree in science and technology. My job is the camera woman for Team Alpha, which is Bryce and Jen. And in my spare time, I like long walks on the beach, yeah, caramel frappuccinos, yoga, and heavy metal music, especially System of the Down.
Mahisa hangs out her tongue and does the two-finger horns. Reggie laughs.
See, that wasn't so hard. And why did you join the team?
Mahisa gets serious, thinks for a couple seconds.
Well, people need help with what Zizi, Jane, and Vartul can do, and with Bryce's resources, I honestly believe we can make a difference. Tonight may just be a couple silly ghosts, and maybe a troll or two, but tomorrow, someone might get attacked by an ogre, or a basilisk, or a gargoyle, a swamp monster, dragon, shapeshifter, harpy, or any one of hundreds of other creatures. And we, Monster Investigations, are the ones to help.
Bravo, well said.
Okay, your turn.
But I'm still in makeup.
Reggie, you're always dressed in some kind of cosplay. That's who you are. Let's roll with it.
Mahisa takes the camera from Reggie, then fusses with his Klingon hair wig.
How's my hair and makeup?
Fierce.
Mahisa begins filming.
As always, all right now, my name's Reggie Montgomery. I'm 25, from Torrance, California, and I went to El Camino Community College, and I'm the cameraman for Team Omega. That's Zizi and Vartul. Obviously, one of my great passions is cosplay, as you can see. Today, I'm Obi-Wan Worf, because I can't decide which one I like better, Star Trek or Star Wars. I usually end up going with both.
And why did you join Monster Investigations?
I grew up with Bryce. Today, may be worth, like, a couple hundred million dollars, but back in the day, we were two of the best D&D players in the state. I wanted to stop and take a note on this one. D&D's not typically competitive. There actually is competitive D&D, but if we're going for that audience, they'd have an issue there. But anyway,
I as the narrator, would like to make a note. I was an official D&D judge, and there was competitive D&D, particularly at Gen Con, the Three Rivers Game Fest, and Icon, where you would play D&D in a competitive tournament style where judges would run campaign packets for different level groups, and people in the campaign packets, if their characters survived, could play in the campaign packet in any con. So it can be competitive.
Yeah, it's just not something that, like, a typical D&D player would brag about, or...
I guess. I'm bragging about it.
All right. Let's leave it to the end, guys.
He'll probably kill me for saying that, but it's true. When he decided to start Monster Investigations, I was the first one he called. I have no idea what I'm in for, and you listening, all those creatures give me pause, but it'll be fun, won't it?
Yoru is Zizi and Vartul. They'll always protect you. You've got nothing to worry about.
Reggie looks a little nervous, but nods in agreement. In Vartul's room, the walls are covered in all kinds of leadership and motivational posters. Tony Robbins, a kitten looking into a mirror reflecting a lion, walk the walk, success is my destiny, believe and achieve. There's got to be the hang in there one, too. Vartul's brushing his teeth while reading the book Seven Habits of Highly Effective People, demons. Vartul used a magic marker. In Jane's room, Jane's bedroom is modern chic and is all about beauty and glamour. Supermodels, design, fashion, Elle, Allure, Cosmo, glamour, hair and beauty magazines are everywhere. She even has a full body head mannequin to practice her makeup and clothing designs on. Jane's makeup table is overloaded with all kinds of products. She picks a few, looks around for something. She walks to the closet. As she gets to the door, she phases, passes through it, like X-Men's Kitty Pryde. I actually have a hyperlink there, too. A couple seconds later, she phases out of the closet with a makeup bag in hand. She packs a bunch of products into it. Jane may not be able to change her looks, but she's going to do everything she can to make sure her friends look their best. In Zizi's room is overflowing with plants. They're everywhere. Peace lily, ficus, dracaena, arrow vine, and ivy is covering most of the walls. Her room's practically a forest. Zizi's wearing her blue blouse, black leather pants, and is sitting on her bed putting on her biker boots. All of a sudden, she stops, sits up straight. Her eyes go wide, her dark brown irises glow. Zizi grabs a sketch pad off the table, and with flash-like speed, she sketches out a scene of a forest. A dense group of tall trees, and in the back they're being pushed aside. Something small and oddly shaped is in the sky. Written on the bottom, 15.3. Zizi returns to normal after her remote viewing, looks at the drawing. She's...
15.3? ¿Qué es eso?
Bryce's room. Bryce's room is what you'd expect from someone who considers himself a player. Satin sheets, erotic and exotic art, animal prints, candles, moonlighting. He's even got handcuffs mounted to each side of his headboard. Bryce stands in front of a mirror, applies some cologne. Loving what he sees, he smiles at his reflection.
If being sexy were a crime, I'd be on death row.
Bryce gives himself a wink of approval. He grabs his smartphone, hits a few buttons. The static of a PA system is heard. Bryce holds the phone to his mouth.
Attention team, it's time to head to the RV. Our first investigation is about to begin.
Montage. Everyone listens to Bryce, reacting in their own way.
Oh, sorry. Each one of you were handpicked for your particular skills and talents, your gifts. Together, we're gonna do great things. Together, we're gonna make a difference, and together, we're gonna get a TV show, become number one, and knock the Creature Crew on their dumb, fake, idiot, phony, stupid asses. Victory!
In the hallway, Vartul walks down the hallway. He's actually super pumped by Bryce. He raises his arms and cries out with him.
Victory! Wake up, kick ass, repeat. Wake up, kick ass, repeat. Wake up.
Jane phases through her bedroom door, joins Vartul.
Make today so awesome that yesterday gets jealous.
Stop saying I wish and start saying I will.
Izzy exits her room and joins them.
Do not wait to strike till the iron is hot, but make it hot by striking it.
Izzy holds up a fist engulfed in flames.
Ooh, I like that.
Exterior, MIHQ in the driveway. The cargo doors are open on the Monster Investigations $1.3 million IV, same cool logo on the sides. Reggie loads camera gear as Mahisa films. Helping Doc load his gear are Trixie and Ninja. Standing to the side is an unhappy Anna Lynn, who's wearing a chauffeur's uniform. Anna Lynn's shaking her head about Trixie and Ninja.
I didn't have a choice. It'll be fine. I'll watch them.
Trixie glares at Anna Lynn.
Neff?
I'm no racist. Goblins are just notorious for being slobs. And I'm darn sure not cleaning up after you.
Doc, Trixie, and Ninja are surprised Anna Lynn understands them.
Yeah, I know goblinese. Is that so shocking?
ZZ, Jane, and Vartul arrive. Ninja freaks out when he sees Vartul. He jumps into the cargo hold, hides behind some suitcases. While Trixie's reaction is the complete opposite, she bats her eyelashes, does a dorky-looking duck lips pout, and gives a flirty wave.
Oop doop doop vimnit dit.
That's Vartul, demon from hell. And don't go starting anything, he's a nice guy. Last thing we need is you corrupting him.
Goblins? Why are there goblins?
Bryce walks up and joins everyone.
Two goblins equals one license. You guys got everything?
All set.
Yep.
Doc grabs the cargo door, looks at Ninja, who's peeking his head out, still terrified.
Come on, Ninja. You gotta ride in there or join us inside. Vartul is not gonna eat you. I told you, he's a good guy. You like Hellboy, yeah? Same thing.
Vartul leans down, smiles at Ninja.
Hey Ninja, what's up, buddy?
Ninja hides behind the gear. Anna Lynn, ZZ, Jean, and Reggie are boarding the RV while Bryce is impatient.
Let's go, Doc! We gotta beat traffic.
Last chance. 3, 2, 1. Fine.
Doc closes the door. Everyone else boards the RV. Inside MI RV, Anna Lynn starts the engine.
Monster Investigations, case number 1. Ponderosa Hotel. Here we come.
I'm sorry. Cheers from
was my delivery good?
And muted cheers from Ninja inside the cargo hold. Anna Lynn closes the door and drives off.
Alright.
End of Act 2. Act 3. In the MIRV moving, Bryce is seated at a table, laptop in front of him, finishing his burger and fries. Mahisa approaches, camera in hand.
You ready for another one-on-one? We still need a few more minutes from everyone.
Anything for my Persian princess?
Mahisa sits. Bryce grabs his smartphone, turns his mirror app, adjusts his hair, checks his teeth.
Persians are Iranian. I'm from India.
Huh? You sure?
Certain. Same continent, though?
I was just thing and you kind of look like that girl in the movie, Prince of Persia.
Ah, yes. The British actress playing a Persian. Perfect casting.
But she is hot, so there's that.
Mahisa smiles. Bryce may be a little sexist, but Mahisa knows he's harmless. She turns on the camera.
Shall we?
Let's rock this.
You said earlier you started this company because you wanted to help people. But why Monster Investigations? Why not a charity, a foundation, or some kind of philanthropic work?
Bryce's cheesy, suave grin disappears. He talks about his past matter-of-factly.
My father died when I was 10. He was my hero, and a real-life hero, too. Besides being a seriously cool dad, he was a fighter pilot in the Marine Corps. Him and his squadron, the VMFA 232 Red Devils, were awarded the Navy Cross for their missions in Afghanistan.
Bryce grabs his wallet, pulls out a photo, shows it to the camera. It's him as a little boy with his father in uniform and mom standing in front of a USMC jet.
That's his FA-18C Hornet, nicknamed Laughing Lucy, after my mom, who used to be the funniest person on the planet.
Bryce grins as he looks at the photo for a few seconds.
He was shot down at 2:34 a.m. in October of 2000. On, wouldn't you know it, Friday the 13th.
Flashed back. A 10-year-old Bryce cries at his dad's funeral. He sits next to his mom, Lucy. 30s, face is expressionless. She just stares ahead as the honor guard folds the American flag. The 21-gun salute. Bryce jumps as the first shots ring out. Lucy doesn't move a muscle, like she didn't even hear it. Bryce's bedroom at night.
On the first anniversary of his death, that's when Monster Investigation was born.
Bryce is sound asleep. The clock on his bedside table goes from 2:33 to 2:34. All of a sudden, his window flies open, bangs against the wall. Bryce sits up, frightened. He looks at the open window, the curtains billowing. The ghost of his father appears as it fades in and out. Bryce is overjoyed.
Dad!
Bryce's dad starts to say something. Like that, he's gone. Bryce waits a few seconds, looks around. He sees the clock. 34.
I ran to my mom's room to tell her what happened.
Bryce bolts out of bed. In Lucy's bedroom, she's asleep. Numerous prescription bottles and some Johnny Walker are on the bedside table. An excited Bryce tries to wake her.
Mom, I saw Dad! Mom!
Lucy rouses and pushes Bryce away.
Your father's dead.
It was a ghost. He was trying to tell me something. Mom.
Lucy's had enough. She sits up and yells at him.
Bryce, shut up. Get out of my room.
Bryce backs away, scared, hurt. Lucy grabs a pill from one of her bottles, downs it with some scotch. She lays back down. Bryce heads for the door.
He's gone. And he's never coming back.
Bryce reaches the door. He hears his mom crying. End flashback. In the MIRV, everyone's engrossed with Bryce's story. Annalyn wipes a tear away. Bryce stares out the window, contemplating.
Every October 13th at 2:34 a.m., I get to see my dad again. And every year, I'm left wondering, what does he want to say to me?
Bryce looks at the camera.
I have to find him. I have to know. I mean, yeah, I could have started a ghost hunting team, but there's already 1,000 of those, and over the years, I've used 46 of them to help me. And every time we got nothing, nada, zero. I gotta try something new, so maybe going bigger, broader.
Bryce shrugs. It's out the window.
All I know is I'm not given up.
Mahisa.
Oh, sorry. You see your father's ghost, and he was a member of the Red Devils. That have anything to do with selecting Jane and Vartul?
Bryce smiles, looks back at Jane and Vartul, who smile back at him.
Absolutely. And the fact that they're both total badasses.
Interior Ponderosa Hotel downstairs in the laundry room. On the far side, a hidden door is open. Inside, part is an old, empty wine cellar. Hannah and David are just getting up from a table when something's on it, but we can't see what it is. Hannah blows out a candle and they exit. After David closes the door, it blends in perfectly with the wall. Even if you were looking for a hidden door, it'd be tough to spot. Hannah looks at her watch.
They should be here any minute.
David's all smiles.
This'll be worth $1 million in advertising.
Concerned, Hannah shakes her head.
We just have to make sure the right guests show up.
David's enthusiasm won't be dampened.
Whoever shows up, whatever shows up, the Ponderosa Hotel is about to become a worldwide destination.
Whatever? If the wrong whatever shows up, the hotel could end up a pile of rubble.
Have a little faith. Monster Investigations has a witch, ghost, and a demon from hell. They're an all-star team. They'll be able to handle it.
This is their first case. Rookies almost always screw up. We can't go too big, otherwise it might backfire.
They head for the stairs. Interior MIRV, Jane's almost done applying Ziz's De Los Muertos makeup, and it's looking spectacular. Zizi notices Mahisa's drawing an elaborate vine design on the back of her hand.
What is that?
It's called henna. It's a common practice in India. A design on the back of the hand is used for defense, protection. The vines symbolize longevity and perseverance.
So that's gonna keep just you safe, or all of us?
All of us.
It's beautiful. You're gonna have to teach me that.
I'll be happy to.
Ah!
On the TV, a commercial for the Creature Cruise starts. The CC is led by Olivia, a blonde who looks like a Victoria's Secrets model. There's also Natasha, a voodoo priestess who looks like Rihanna. Piers, a British vampire that resembles David Beckham, and Gary, a grim reaper who has a skeleton head with bright blue eyes. Besides Gary, the Creature's crew is very attractive, just one of the reasons they're number one. Part of the commercial shows each one of them in slow-mo. Olivia's running, her boobs bouncing, obviously for Mark.
Those are so fake!
Zizi's enjoying the show. Without even thinking, she says,
"They look pretty good to me."
Everyone looks at ZZ. Jane grins. ZZ's eyes widen, realizing what she said. She tries to cover.
"I mean, they look real, is all."
Embarrassed, ZZ looks down. Back to the commercial.
Oh, join us tonight for reality TV's number one show. As the Creature Crew battles a gang of outlaw Sobeks that are hell-bent on terrorizing the helpless communities of the southern Everglades.
A Sobek is an Egyptian crocodile god. The commercial shows the team fighting the Sobeks with martial arts. Olivia, magic, Natasha, flying with brute strength, Piers, and Gary with his scythe. The action is also truly impressive.
That are hellbent on terrorizing the helpless communities. Give me a break.
They don't even have any tech.
Is that good or bad?
Bryce turns off the TV and throws the remote to the side. Annalyn drives around a bend and spots the Ponderosa Hotel.
Okay, team, we're here.
Bryce walks to the front, still upset and annoyed.
Bryce, honey, you need to let go of the past. What those two did was wrong, but this is our first case. You have to lead your team with a positive attitude and love in your heart. Drop the bitterness, the contempt, and let's kick some butt tonight. Okay, sweetie?
Bryce smiles and nods.
I know, you're right. As always, Rodful should have a poster of you in his room.
Only if I'm in a thong bikini.
Annalyn pulls the RV into the lot, parks, and opens the door. David and Hannah have come out to greet the team as they exit.
Welcome to the Ponderosa Hotel. Glad you could make it.
Thank you for having us.
I sure hope you folks can help us. Things got pretty crazy the other night.
I know we can. We got a secret weapon.
Bryce motions to Jane as she exits the RV.
That's right. You have got a ghost on your team. You've got an insider, huh?
Oh, great. Put all the pressure on me.
Hannah and David shake Jane's hand. Hannah's enthralled.
Can you, you know, fade in and out and fly and all that stuff?
Jane smiles, floats up, and fades out. Jane.
You mean like this?
Jane reappears behind them.
Who?
David and Hannah jump. Then they laugh.
Let me introduce you to the rest of the team.
As Bryce introduces the team, they all shake hands. Doctor, doctor.
Bartle is our demon, obviously. He has the strength of the Incredible Hulk and can breathe fire.
Your nickname should be Red Dragon.
Artul's eyes widen.
Oh, I like that.
Mex is ZZ, our bruja, or Mexican witch. ZZ is extremely powerful.
ZZ's being shy, still a bit embarrassed.
I love your makeup, but why exactly...
Theatrics? And ratings?
She's gonna look fantastic on camera.
As Doc exits the RV, he looks up at the fading light.
Bro, we should hustle to set up before we lose the light.
Okay, you guys get started. I'll do a walkthrough with Hannah and David.
We should probably have one person from each team on the walkthrough and Mahisa filming. Don't you think?
Oh, yeah. Good call. Warful. ZZ.
Jugo.
Camera in hand, Mahisa jogs past everyone so she can film them walking up to the hotel. Vertul joins Bryce, Hannah, and David as they head for the hotel. Reggie opens the cargo door. Ninja sprints past him and runs towards the forest.
Ninja?
Can I do you?
He's gotta pee.
Everyone grabs their gear and starts setting up. Interior in the Ponderosa Hotel banquet room, Mahisa films as David, Hannah, Bryce, and Vertul enter.
So when exactly will this episode air?
And what station's it gonna be on?
Bryce and Vertul share a look, nervous-like.
Well, officially we don't have a show yet. We'll use footage from tonight's investigation to put together a demo reel. Then our agent will send it to a bunch of networks and producers.
A bit surprised, David and Hannah look at each other. It's easy to see their disappointment.
Trust me, we'll have dozens of people fighting to get your case on the air.
You guys have a YouTube channel, right?
Yeah. We'll also upload the video to our channel, obviously.
And how many followers do you have?
Well, again, we're just getting started, so...
Jane and Reggie!
Bryce looks at Mahisa confused. He doesn't get it.
Jane has over 5 million followers on her beauty and makeup channel, and Reggie has about 800,000 for his cosplay channel. I'm sure once they put the word out to their followers, Monster Investigations will be one of the most popular channels on YouTube.
Hannah and David are happy to hear that. A loud crash in another room startles everyone. Vertul grabs Bryce's arm. Bryce gives him a dirty look. Vertul mouths, "Sorry, let's go." Luckily, David and Hannah didn't notice. Outside in the forest, Ninja merrily sings in Goblinese as he takes a whiz. Ninja, sing away. Suddenly, something speeds by. Startled, Ninja looks around. Now something speeds by him the other way. Scared, he quickly zips up and runs. In the banquet room, Bryce, Vertul, Hannah, David, and Mahisa walk to the door where the noise came from.
Is anybody else here?
No, the place is empty, like you asked.
Have you seen ghosts in any other rooms?
just the banquet room, and just that one night.
Have you seen anything else besides ghosts?
No. Like what?
Trolls?
David and Hannah are surprised. Shocked, even.
Trolls? I've never heard of trolls in this.
Bryce opens the kitchen door. No one can believe what they're seeing. All the pantry doors are open, and there are numerous upside-down pyramids of canned goods.
Gravity says, what?
Outside in the parking lot, a freaked-out ninja sprints out from the forest and runs up to Doc.
Bro, calm down. It was probably just a deer or something. Okay, I'll check it out. But we have to set up first.
Annalyn overheard Ninja. She looks into the woods, leery. In the kitchen, Fartul goes to the closest pyramid, pulls out a can of tomato sauce from the second lowest level. Nothing happens.
That seems a bit odd. Try and...
All the pyramids crash to the ground, and the cans start flying back into the cupboards. Everyone ducks. Once all the cans are back in, the doors slam shut. Bryce looks at Mihisa.
Please say yes.
I got it.
Outside in the parking lot, part of the RV is a section that extends. It's the command center where a wall of monitors have been set up. Also a table, a couple keyboards, joystick, remote control. Doc, Jane, Annalyn, ZZ, Ninja, and Trixie are finishing up with all the tech stuff as Reggie films. ZZ opens a case. Inside are 36 black spheres the size of racquetballs. Each one has a bunch of micro-camera lenses. ZZ pulls one out. It's kind of sticky. She studies it.
ZZ.
What are these?
Doc.
Doc smiles. Hold on one second.
Sorry, I was busy trying to get Smish to go use the bathroom.
So I think she just left to do it.
Yes.
I got a
so I got call. So distracted.
I got a phone call. There was, in that exact moment was chaotic.
Okay.
Damn it, trying to get this chick to go pee. I missed my line.
Are we on pause?
We're on your line. Doc smiles and grabs one.
Oh, I was waiting for Doc to speak.
Oh.
Okay, Doc's I didn't hear you finish your...
Oh, I'm sorry. I paused because the phone rang, and then I thought that we were waiting on somebody else.
Okay,
go ahead,
dude.
Doc.
No problem. Our cameras, each one is coated in an adhesive polymer and has 15 micro cameras surrounding it, so it doesn't matter how we put them up.
Doc tosses the camera up into the corner of the extension. It sticks in place.
We'll put one in the corner of each room. That'll give us complete 360 coverage.
ZZ?
No wires?
Wi-Fi.
Bryce, Fartul, and Mihisa join them. All three are smiling.
You won't believe what just happened.
I'll send it to the main screen.
Mihisa hits a couple buttons on her camera. Everyone looks at the main monitor, the biggest one in the middle. When Bryce opens the door to the kitchen is where it starts playing. Everyone looks at the upside-down can of pyramids. Jane's more surprised than anyone. Fartul pulls the tomato can sauce out.
When was the fire? Like 3 years ago?
Yes, 2 years and 10 months.
The cans crash, fly back into the shelves, the door slams.
Even with two of them, there's no way... Can you hear me?
Yes, go on.
Even with two of them, there's no way they could be that powerful. Every ghost has telekinesis, but it takes years and years to develop, if at all. After a decade, some can barely move a marble, while others...
Jane looks at a Ponderosa work truck in the lot. She points a hand at it, flicks her wrist up. The truck zooms hundreds of feet up in the air, practically disappearing. Jane lowers her wrist. The truck plummets back down. Stops 6 feet above the ground. Jane drops her hand. The truck plops down.
So the magician and clown didn't do that?
Nope. Impossible.
Okay, so we got a party crasher. What else have you got?
Cameras and weapons.
I'm not going to use a weapon, so I'll take care of the cameras.
Jane points to the camera case, telekinetically closes the lid. She flies into the hotel. The case floats behind her. Doc opens a large rifle case. It holds 3 futuristic rifles, 2 handguns, and a bunch of ammo and mags.
Each team gets 1 Trident rifle and 1 Ultra handgun. Well, I guess Jane doesn't want one, but anyway.
Doc grabs a rifle and a bullet. This projectile is red.
Trident, because you have 3 options. Red is electroshock, basically a taser.
Doesn't that need a power supply?
Doc points to the bottom of the projectile.
Battery. State of the art, of course. Stun guns can kick out 7.5 million volts. This nasty girl is 20.
Doc pulls out a bullet with a white projectile.
White is knockout gas, though it's really more of a Cadiz fog, and it won't disperse more than 5 feet from the target. So as long as you're like 6 feet away, doesn't matter which way the wind blows.
Doc grabs a blue projectile bullet.
Blue is option 3. Foam, highly concentrated. Once the target is hit, a microchip will scan it and disperse an appropriate amount of foam over the entire body, avoiding the head and suffocation. The foam will harden in 2 to 3 seconds, immobilizing the subject.
So if I hit a 15-foot tall giant, it'll cover the entire body just the same as if I hit a 3-foot hobbit?
Doc smiles and nods, proud of his work.
Yep. That microchip took me like an entire 2 weeks to design and build.
Everyone's impressed, but Bryce is in awe.
Damn, Doc. That's crazy impressive.
Doc flips the rifle on its side, shows everyone red, white, and blue buttons.
Thanks. Just tap the button of the round you want to use. The rifle will automatically load it.
Will any of those work on ghosts? Like, tonight?
If you could catch them in solid form, yes. If not, the Ultra Handgun, an ultrasonic sound blaster. In ghost form, ghosts are nothing more than aligned energy. There's a sensor in the grip. The tighter you squeeze, the more powerful the sonic blast. A light squeeze for a ghost is like being hit with a taser. A full squeeze is complete energy dispersal. Poof. End of story. End of ghost. Obviously, avoid hitting Jane.
Jane has just flown back. She overheard the very end.
Avoid Jane? Oh, the ultrasonic blaster. Yeah, I've already died once, and I'm just starting to have fun again. So, super play, don't disintegrate me.
I'll try my best. Okay, let's get going. Team Omega, start at the top. Work your way down. Alpha, we'll flip it. Start in the basement and head up.
Doc opens another case. Earcoms, cameras for everyone. Each earcom has a mini camera attached to it.
Everyone, grab a comm cam.
Everyone does. Inserts them. Bryce, ZZ strap on black holsters for their handguns. Bartool and Bryce grab their rifles. Doc opens another smaller case, the Google-type glasses.
Bryce, glasses.
I can see everyone's camera on these, right?
Yep, plus everything else you wanted.
Nice.
Let's gather around, please.
Annalyn puts her hands out, grabs hold of ZZ and Bryce's hands. Everyone else does the same. The team's formed a circle. Everyone holds hands and bows their head. Except for Vartul and Jane, they don't bow their heads.
Dear Lord, I ask that you watch over and protect everyone on our team tonight. Keep us safe no matter what we may encounter, be it a ghost, a troll, a Wendigo, the Leshy, or whatever other creature that may seek to do us harm.
Standing across from each other, like a couple bored little kids, Vartul and Jane make faces at each other.
And please guide us to make the right decision if a crisis may occur. With all of our love and respect, amen.
Bryce claps his hands together, rubs them, and smiles.
Okay, let's get some names and take some ass. Stay sharp and good luck.
End of Act 3. Act 4, Interior Ponderosa, Basement. Mahisa films Bryce and Jane walking down the stairs. Bryce taps a button on the side of his glasses. The lenses turn red. From Bryce's POV, we see 5 camera screens in the upper left corner. Jane's, Mahisa's, Bartul's, ZZ's, and Reggie's. Red lenses means he's now seeing in thermal heat vision. Bryce looks around, notices a section on the far corner wall, hidden room, is cooler than the rest.
Doc, you getting this?
Outside, in MI Command Center, Doc and Annalyn sit at the table, watch all the monitors. Trixie and Ninja are sitting on a couple camping chairs behind them, enjoying some candy. Doc switches Bryce's thermal POV to the main screen.
That's too uniform to be a vent or something. I'll get the blueprints.
Doc types. Seconds later, the blueprints are on the screen. He scrolls through them. The hidden room is labeled Wine Cellar.
It's a wine cellar.
Inside the Ponderosa basement, Team Alpha arrives at the door. Bryce is confused.
There's no door or even a handle. Why would you hide a wine cellar?
I'll check it out.
Jane phases through the wall. Bryce taps the button on his glasses again. Green lenses. He looks around the basement with night vision. Taps again. Purple lenses. He looks around with ultraviolet vision. Jane sticks the top half of her body through the wall, extends her hands to Bryce and Mahisa.
Bad news. You gotta see this.
Bryce and Mahisa hold hands with Jane, allowing them to phase through the wall too. Inside the secret room, Jane's already lit the candle. Sitting on the table are a funky-looking radio-type box and a deck of cards. Each card has some weird runic sigil magic-type symbol on it. Bryce fans out the cards and shakes his head.
Great. Summoning cards.
Those are illegal for a reason. They're too dangerous. You never know who or what is going to answer.
Is that a radio?
Spirit box. Guess they were hoping to hear a reply.
Bryce puts a finger to his comm cam, enabling all comms.
Okay, everyone, listen up. We found a deck of summoning cards and a spirit box in the basement. We just went from ghosts and maybe trolls to everything else on the planet. Stay sharp.
Why would they do that?
David and Hannah kept asking about when the show was going to air and if we have a YouTube channel. They never even asked if we can get rid of the ghosts.
So, for publicity?
Yep. And the grand opening of a hotspot hotel. The public loves that stuff. As soon as this episode airs, they'll be booked solid for the next decade.
How wonderful. Our first case, and we're being used.
Bastards. Exterior, MI Command Center. Annalyn nervously looks around.
Hotspot? You got any more weapons?
The prototype for the Trident, but it's kind of glitchy.
Better than nothing.
Doc stands, looks at Trixie Ninja who are goofing around.
You guys not paying attention? We just went from an ankle buster to a tidal wave. Quit screwing around and keep your eyes open.
Ninja yells back.
Ihr färber mir auf Ginchgen mir dicker, but kids it say.
Yeah, yeah. You told me something when in the forest. You're the King Kahuna.
Inside the Ponderosa third floor, Reggie films ZZ and Bartul reaching the third floor. Bartul holds a hand out, sensing something.
It's getting a lot warmer every floor.
Maybe they're saving money. Turned off the air conditioner. Heat rises.
They're at the top of the stairs in the middle of the floor. Bartul extends his arm both ways. He looks to the left.
I don't think so. It's 52.8 degrees hotter that way.
Easy, the fearless adrenaline junkie, starts heading left.
Let's see why.
Bartul and Reggie follow. Bartul gets his rifle ready. Meanwhile, outside in MI Command Center, Doc taps the Trident's red button, leans it against the table between him and Annalyn. As Doc's about to sit, he pauses.
Do you feel that?
No. What was it?
Doc brushes it off, shakes his head.
Oh, nothing. Just being paranoid.
Tu fais rien à Tioko Mivdizbe.
Your weapons. Don't you guys know... Shoot. Don't you guys know magic?
Embarrassed, Trixie and Ninja lower their heads.
It then mem?
A little? Well then, dudes, you got a little weapon.
Inside the Ponderosa basement, Bryce is following Jane. They're at the other end of the laundry room. Jane stops, turns to Bryce.
They're here.
Inside the Ponderosa third floor, halfway down the hallway, ZZ and Reggie are noticeably feeling the heat. Bartul's fine. ZZ shakes her head.
¿Qué hace calor, hombre?
ZZ holds her hands out. Strong air currents emerge from her palms. Air is one of the four elements she's mastered. Earth, air, fire, and water. The immediate area is instantly cooler.
That's bet.
The last door on the left begins to radiate with heat. It glows brighter and brighter until it explodes. Inside the Ponderosa basement, Jane relaxes. It's wrapped.
Okay, guys, show yourselves.
Ghost magician and clown appear. They seem desperate, scared.
Praise Jesus, you're here. You have to help us.
That ass monkey won't let us leave.
What, the owners, David and Hannah? Are they making you stay here to help the business?
Magician and clown are confused.
No, they're cool. They just asked us to liven up their party a little.
And the only reason we could was because Pyro was gone. But he's back, and he's pissed. He even...
Boom! Everyone ducks from the explosion on the third floor.
Run!
Poof. Magician and clown disappear. Bryce's POV, he's looking at Team Omega's cameras. A poltergeist is slowly emerging from the room. It's completely covered in fire. Its face is grotesquely scarred from burns.
Oh, man. I think we just met who set the fire 3 years ago. Third floor, now.
Interior Ponderosa third floor. ZZ stands strong, glares at the poltergeist, Pyro, while Vartul covers behind her. Cowers.
Oh boy.
As ZZ quick draws her handgun, Pyro shoots a flame at it, destroying the gun. ZZ drops it, grabs her hand.
Ah!
ZZ's injury ignites Vartul's anger. He fires at Pyro, but Pyro phases. The bullet passes through him, breaks the window behind him. Pyro raises his hands, blasts flames at them. Vartul gets in front of ZZ, takes the blast of fire in the chest. Bartul charges Pyro. ZZ yells at him.
Bartul, don't! There's a...
Just as Bartul leaps, Pyro phases out. Bartul flies through the window, plummets 3 stories to the ground.
Window!
As soon as Pyro phases back in, ZZ unleashes hurricane force winds from her hands. Pyro phases out completely. He's gone. Outside in the MI Command Center, on the monitors, Doc and Annalyn watch Vartul crash to the ground. They're shocked, confused.
Good lord, what do we do?
Bryce, Vartul just fell like 3 stories. Should we go help him?
No, he's my partner. I got him.
Trixie starts running to where Vartul fell. Ninja's annoyed, but quickly follows. Annalyn feels something. She looks around.
Okay, I felt that.
Inside the Ponderosa stairs, Bryce and Mahisa race up the stairs as Jane phases through the ceiling.
Go help him, ZZ. We'll be there in a second.
The pyro guys disappeared.
In the Ponderosa third floor, ZG and Reggie are at the broken window. Jane phases up through the floor and looks at him.
I got Reggie.
ZZ jumps out the window. Outside in the Ponderosa north side, ZZ uses the air currents from her hands to guide her safely down. Up at the window, Jane telekinetically lowers Reggie, who never stops recording. ZZ's kneeling by Vartul, who's sitting up.
I did not stick that landing.
Both feel the ground shake. They look around.
Something big's coming!
Doc! Eye in the sky!
Exterior, MI Command Center, Doc's typing and we can hear the rear roof of the RV open. Doc grabs the joystick remote control.
Already slightly ahead of you.
A drone flies out of the roof and speeds high into the north. Interior, exterior, Ponderosa, on the third floor and the north side, Jane looks into the forest, searches for whatever's making the footsteps everyone can now hear. Trees are being pushed aside as the drone flies into view. Jane seeing the picture at ZZ sketched earlier. ZZ sees the drone, looks at Jane, her irises momentarily glow. Inside the Ponderosa, Bryce and Mahisa reach the third floor and run to Jane. At the top of the stairs are two vending machines and an ice machine.
Bartool's okay.
Thanks, Satan?
Bryce looks out the window.
Doc, you see anything?
On the drone POV, the drone spots night vision, three giant trolls approaching. A click, then radar beams hit each troll, measuring them. There's also a dozen other trolls of all sizes. They're heading to where ZZ and Bartul are. Outside the MI Command Center, the drone's cameras on the main monitor.
We got about a dozen trolls and three giant ones heading our way. The biggest is...
15.3? 15 feet, 3 in... How'd you know that?
Yeah, so script note.
Wait, that was weird.
I think that line is supposed to be Doc's line.
Yep.
Yeah, I think so.
You would say 15.3,
right,
then
I would say twice. That doesn't make any sense.
Right, exactly. Dude, like 15 feet 3? How'd you know that?
I had a vision. Actually, it was Jane's vision. That's never happened before.
Inside the Ponderosa, Bryce is not happy to hear that.
Why did you warn us?
I just saw some bent trees and 15.3. I didn't know what it meant.
Mahisa hears something, turns, and her eyes widen.
Guys, Pyro's back.
Bryce and Jane turn. At the other end, Pyro floats towards them.
He can't shoot fire unless he's in solid form. Hit him then, even if I'm in the way.
That's not gonna happen.
Pyro points to a vending machine, sends it hurtling at them. Jane stops it, sends it back at Pyro with even greater force. Pyro phases out. The machine slams into the wall. Pyro phases all the way back in, starts glowing with flames.
Get ready.
Bryce taps the blue foam button and aims at Pyro. Outside, in the north side, ZZ faces the window, game face on and ready for battle, while Vartul, standing behind her, is scared and slowly backing away. Reggie's taking steps back with Vartul.
I'll take that, big.
ZZ sees Vartul backing away.
This isn't... No. I didn't sign up. I'm not... This is crazy.
You're as strong as them. Come on.
Bartul keeps backing away, not wanting any part of this.
No. They're twice my size, so they're twice as strong. I can't.
ZZ's upset, and she marches up to him.
Damn it, Bartul! WWTRD! What would Tony Robbins do?
That hits Bartul hard. His fear replaced by thoughts of his motivator, his spirit guide, Mr. Tony Robbins.
It is in your moments of decision your destiny is shaped. Focus on where you want to go, not on what you fear.
The giant trolls are practically there. The time is now.
The path of success is to take massive, determined action.
Bartool's pumped up. ZZ picks up a pebble and tosses it to him.
The first giant that comes out, throw it at him.
This won't do anything.
It will when I'm done with it.
Just then, the first giant troll emerges. Bartool hurls the pebble at it. ZZ follows the rock with her hands. The pebble grows to the size of a car, smashes the troll's face, knocking him down and out. ZZ grins at Bartool.
One down.
Bartool's smiling big time. He's even more pumped.
Hell yeah!
Trixie arrives with Bartool's trident. She taps his leg, hands it to him. Zninja stands by ZZ. These guys gonna fight too? Inside the Ponderosa on the third floor, Jane's in front of Bryce and Mahisa. Pyro's closed the gap. He's now solid and covered in flames. Pyro unleashes an ungodly amount of fire at them. Jane stops the flames with her telekinesis. Bryce moves to the side, shoots his trident, but the round disintegrates on impact.
Bullets aren't gonna work if he's on fire!
Handgun! Handgun!
It's like Bryce forgot about it.
Oh, yeah.
Bryce drops the trident, grabs the ultra. He aims. At the same time Bryce fires, Pyro telekinetically slings Jane forward into the path of the ultrasonic blast. Jane screams. It's the floor, unconscious. Bryce is shocked. Shocked.
No! Jane!
Pyro flames on even more, blasts fire at Bryce and Mahisa. Outside, in the north side, the two giants and the other dozen trolls exit the forest. Bartool aims his trident. ZZ's ready. So are Ninja and Trixie. Just as they're about to act, two scout trolls zoom in, fast as the flash, and knock the team on their asses. Trixie and Ninja are mad. They look at each other, nod. Kind of like the Wonder Trins. Wonder Twin powers activate. Ninja and Trixie do some weird hand thing. They touch thumbs, then forefingers, pinkies. Fusion.
Do. Says do.
Do.
Yes, do.
Ninja and Trixie speed off, also just as fast as the Flash, chasing the scout trolls. In slow-mo, we watch an angry Ninja and Trixie racing right behind the frightened scout trolls. Bartool fires at a giant. The blue foam quickly spreads, covers the giant from the neck down. The foam hardens, the giant falls, but at impact, the hardened foam shatters. The giant shakes it off and stands. ZZ aims her hands at the ground in front of the trolls. Vines pop out of the ground, wrap around all the trolls' legs.
Hit the big one with gas!
Bartool hits the red button. Wrong one! Fires! The giant twitches, spasms from an electroshock. But that only angers it. It rips out all of the vines and charges.
Blank! White! White button!
Bartool hits the white button. Inside, on the third floor, Pyro shoots flames at Bryce and Mahisa. Bryce grabs Mahisa, shoves her down and himself into the room with the missing door. They crash to the floor. Bryce helps her up. He's panicked.
Oh god, oh my god. Jane, you think?
She's fine. She's just unconscious.
Dizzy, we need you up here. Now!
Little busy, fighting 14 trolls.
Dizzy, no!
Oh, I forgot to mention. 14 trolls!
Bryce is starting to freak out. He looks at a window.
So, either jump from three stories or burn to death. What's a couple of broken legs versus being melted?
As Bryce turns to Mahisa, she covers his comm cam with her hand. She's already turned hers off, no red light.
Turn off your comm cam.
Bryce gives her a what the hell look.
Turn it off!
Use the force, Luke. Bryce flips the switch. It's off.
I need your word. You have to promise me this stays between us, yes or no.
What are you?
Yes or no.
Bryce looks at the open door. Pyro's only a few feet away.
Yes, yes, I promise.
Outside in MI Command Center, Doc and Annalyn look at Bryce and Mahisa's black screens.
Bryce! Mahisa, you're both offline! Bryce! Mahi!
Suddenly, the comm cams are back on, but Bryce and Mahisa are at the south end of the hall. Doc and Annalyn watch as the two quietly run up to Jane. Up ahead, Pyro's about to enter the room they were just in. Doc's confused. Annalyn's watching something in the woods.
How did...
Is that... Oh, no.
Annalyn grabs the trident and stands. At the edge of the woods is a banshee. She's wearing ZZ and Vartul, but she's watching ZZ and Vartul fight. She seems more curious than anything. The banshee glances at Annalyn and Doc, then fades back into the woods.
Thank you, Lord. Banshees scare the heck out of me.
Exterior Ponderosa, the two giant trolls charge Vartul, while the other dozen race for ZZ. Vartul hits one of the banshees, or one of the giants, with knockout gas. It coughs, struggles, coughs, but goes down. ZZ blasts the first troll, charging her with hurricane winds, blowing it back into a tree. ZZ closes her fist at the tree. The tree's limbs wrap around the troll, securing it in place. She does it again and again and again. The third giant is on Vartul before he can fire. It punches him, sends him flying back. Vartul crashes into the hotel. His trident breaks in half on impact. Vartul's pissed. He stands and glares at the 10-foot troll.
You can't wait for inspiration. You have to go after it with a club.
Vartul slams a fist into his palm. He runs, leaps, punches the giant in the face. The two start brawling and duking it out. Meanwhile, inside the Ponderosa's third floor, Bryce rolls over Jane, taps her cheek.
Jane! Jane! Wake up!
Jane awakens. Bryce helps her sit up.
I'm okay. Ça va bien.
Jane sees Pyro entering the room at the end of the hall.
Go get it.
Pyro's just entering the room. Bryce has his ultra handgun ready. Him and Mahisa run to the end of the hall. Pyro's looking around the room when they arrive. Bryce blasts him with the full force of the ultra. Ultrasonic waves instantly extinguish Pyro's flames. He tries to fly at Bryce, but he's being disintegrated. In 3 to 4 seconds, Pyro's been completely vaporized.
Good job, Bryce.
Bryce smiles, gives Mahisa a look.
Great teamwork, Mahisa.
Outside the Ponderosa on the north side, Vartul's getting the upper hand on the giant. With every punch, he's getting stronger, and tosses out another quote.
Don't stop until you're proud of yourself. Be stronger than your excuses. I can, and I will. Watch me!
ZZ's trying something new in the remaining trolls. With her hands together, she pushes them out and separates them and forms a circle. As she pushes them out, fire shoots, lands in front of the troll, and encircles it in a wall of flames up to its neck. She does it 2 more times, trapping the last 4 trolls in circular walls of fire. 1 last punch from Vartul, and the giant troll topples over, unconscious. Vartul and ZZ smile at each other, triumphant.
Nice job, big guy.
Couldn't have done it without you. Thanks for the pep talk.
Trixie and Ninja speed in, each holding a scout troll by the hair. Both are smiling, proud of themselves.
Whoa. Great catch, guys.
Da 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 da. ZZ points to the ground. Vines rise out and encircle the scouts, securing them in place. Outside in the parking lot, the teams gathered as David and Hannah pull in, everyone glaring at them as they exit their car.
Everything's taken care of, though your hotel experienced some damage.
Like what?
On the third floor, you got a broken window and exploded door caused by a super pissed off poltergeist that was on fire. Oh, and there's a vending machine stuck in the wall.
Hannah's upset.
Are you going to pay cash or check?
Good one. We found the wine cellar and your Sony cards. You do know it's illegal to use those, right?
David and Hannah react, but immediately recover.
Summoning cards?
Wine cellar? What are you talking about?
Doc's had enough.
Dude, I've already scanned the cards and got your fingerprints off them. And to get a match, I got a copy of your fingerprints from military records, Air Force. And I got yours from the Sacramento Police Department. Two DUIs and a public intoxication? Don't play dumb.
David and Hannah look at each other. Busted, they concede.
Okay, we just...
wanted some free advertisement. Yeah, well, lucky for you, you're still gonna get that. But you're also gonna give it. There's gonna be a monster investigation kiosk in your lobby. Videos, brochures, postcards, keychains, t-shirts, hats, buttons, frisbees, and whatever else I wanna add.
Bryce, ever the opportunist. The team staring at him, impressed with his demands.
Maintained and restocked by you. Are we clear?
David and Hannah smile and nod. Actually, they like the idea.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Yes,
and script note. Yeah, script note, I think that's supposed to be David instead of Frank.
That's right, yeah. It's Frank. He told us about that.
Say, I'm like, wait. Yeah.
Exterior parking lot. Everyone's outside the RV, loading the last of the gear. A concerned Doc approaches Bryce, smartphone in hand.
Bro, have you actually read all these rules investigation teams have to follow? Never mind, that's rhetorical. Because if you did, you'd know we've got a humongous problem. It says, in the event of any capture, you are required to immediately notify the DOMC.
Shit. Everyone sees Doc's urgency and paying attention.
DOMC?
Department of Monsters and Creatures. We don't have our license.
What? Bryce?
We have it. I mean, it's been issued. It's just... it's in the mail.
We have two options. We don't call them and hope they never find out, which is highly unlikely. And when they do find out, our license will definitely be revoked. Probably forever. Or we call them and explain what's going on and just pray they're down with it. But considering DOMC agents are notorious tight asses, also highly unlikely.
Exasperated once again, Bryce throws his head back and thinks.
We could let the trolls go. No capture, no call.
Reggie!
But then we can't use the footage. We were able to capture all these trolls, but then we lost them?
Bryce,
the leader.
Yeah, let's just make us look bad, like we don't know what we're doing.
No network's gonna hire a bunch of losers like that. There's another option. Call them. I got this.
Of course, Annalyn's got it. Annalyn heads for the RV.
Trust me. Call them.
You heard the lady.
Later, in the background, three military CH-47 Chinook helicopters lift all the netted trolls up and fly away. A couple men in black looking agents are with Bryce and the team. The female senior agent hands some paperwork to Bryce while the male junior agent is still in his smartphone.
Here's your license back. This is quite the first case. With everything going on out there, we need more teams like you.
Junior agent addresses senior.
Incidents. Palm Springs.
No rest for the wicked. Keep up the good work.
The agents go to their blacked out and silent helicopters. Fly away. Bryce lets out a sigh of relief and looks at Annalyn.
I had no idea you were a counterfeiter.
Technically, it's forgery. And we all have secrets.
Bryce glances at Nahisa, Doc noticed. End of Act 4. Tag. Interior MIRV moving. It's been a long day and a longer night. Most everyone's asleep. Bryce, who's sitting across the aisle and one row up from Nahisa, watches her sleep. Nahisa opens her eyes. looks right back at him. She puts a finger to her lips. Shh, and goes back to sleep. Bryce looks out his window and smiles.
Number one, baby. Number one.
Doc, sitting in back in the dark, saw that exchange too. He opens his laptop on a torch, Tor search engine webpage, he types Mahisa Mallaretti. After a brief pause, he adds powers, abilities, hits enter. Outside in the forest, right off the highway, the banshee from earlier flies through the woods. She's following the RV. The end.
Yay!
Yeah! Yay. Yo, that everyone was on point.
Oh my god, I have so much gas right now.
Yeah, we heard them all.
Freaking Anna Lynn, wow, Jesus.
I've had so many burps that, like, just came at the wrong time.
The voice acting was the best for this table read of every table read we've done so far.
It was the best. You guys so nailed it.
Oh my
gosh. Awesome.
Script chick. My goodness. Great job.
Yeah, seriously, really good.
Thank you very much.
Actress quality. Like, go get a job on Hollywood already. Come on.
I was listening to character's name, Mahisha. I was thinking like Tally from Mass Effect. I'm like, it kind of sounds like that. If anyone's played that game.
I think the strongest nod, other than the fact that we had good voice acting this table read, is that the character work was so strong that it enabled an opportunity for the voice acting, and for something that's a pilot, that's the most important thing, because beyond whatever the plot is for the story itself, it's the characters that's the most important in the TV script, and above all, above anything else in the script, the character work is the strongest of every attribute in the script. It's really impressive work by this.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, all the characters were so unique and talked in their own special way, and that's always cool when you see that.
Just to make a point here on the recording, a very smart screenwriting thing that he did, I made a point of mentioning it in the chat, is for the first two acts of the story, each character had what they are next to the name. Jane, the ghost. Bryce, the leader. Santiago, the agent. That's something that a lot of people would overlook as being important, because maybe you have a Bible, maybe you have strong character introductions, but by having that, especially when you have such a diverse and very different cast, it really nails it into the reader's mind what each character is. And I think that's something that would have made it something minor, but the script would have been a lot more difficult without it. What do you guys think?
Yeah, I really like that.
Yeah, I agree with that.
Yeah.
Yep, same here.
It's smart.
I agree too.
I've never seen that before.
I apologize for those two things that happened from my end.
So what do you guys think are the strongest attributes of the script? What do you guys like the most?
Script chick.
I thought it was really fun. I just thought this would be a fun thing to watch. There's always a lot of action going on. Everyone has different magical abilities. Like, the clowns are funny with their jokes. And I just think it would be, like, visually entertaining to watch on TV.
I agree. I think this would be a very fun television show. Mm-hmm. And I think that the fun aspect is probably one of its strongest selling points.
I think I would to improve on the fun even more, because I do really like pretty much all the characters. And they are very distinct. I just wish they would kind of butt heads, like, not like I hate you, but have more interaction, because it seemed sometimes that they were too on the same level with each other.
Right, like, there was a lot of teamwork, handshaking, as opposed to internal conflict, making it difficult so that way in the end they can come together and have a resolution. Right?
Right. Yeah, I agree. Yeah.
I think what you're saying can be tied into another aspect that can be used to improve. What there is there's the straightforward plot of the story, right? There's the Ponderosa. They have to go there, right? There's also a small B story. The B story is that they need their license. And in the end, it becomes sort of a non-issue thanks to Annalyn's smart thinking, but that's a character solution, not exactly a deus ex machina. But what the script could use is a C story. And the C story can be a cause for concern that involves every single member of the team in a different way, and their conflict can be over the C story. And it would be something that would be added through dialogue from the start of the script to the end characters would argue about. It would be a point of contention, like Script Chick is saying. There needs to be that conflict. A third plot line that can have an emotional catharsis and resolution at the end.
I'll say one point, and I want to know what you guys think about it. The fact it's a dramedy, and so I can see then how it would fit into a one-hour format, but I'm just wondering if it's A, like, enough drama and also enough comedy. Like, I saw this more as, like, a comedy format and it not really needing to be 66 pages long. But if it is a dramedy, then that's obviously a different take on it. But I would want more, at least from the comedy end, I wanted more jokes on the page.
Are you saying that you think, would it be stronger as a half-hour show and the pilot is 2 episodes?
I mean, it really depends on the tone, because, like, half-hour, like, because it starts off, I get the vibe of The Office, you know, we're doing those, the talking heads.
Right.
And then at the end of it, we're more into Ghostbusters, like action fighting. And so that's why I'm kind of a little bit unsure about the tone right now, because I don't feel like it's really found its footing yet.
On one level, it could be a stylistic choice. For example, Law and Order has a part A and a part B. If every episode was stylized so that the first part is the setup, and an office type situation with a B story, and then the second half is them addressing what was brought up in the setup and resolving it. It could be part of formula. I don't know if that was done intentionally, because I see what you mean, like the tonal shift throughout it. But I found it equally exciting through the setup to the end, in regards of the way it worked. I can see how there's that feel of the tone. I don't know. What do you guys think?
Well, I was going to say, just to kind of piggyback on what you were saying earlier about team conflict, right? And I would just add that instead of trying to resolve it in this pilot, let it carry out, right? So leave it unresolved.
That's a good point. You're right. It could be something that continues to bother people.
Yeah.
You're saying the setup. The setup normally is you have the pilot and it leads into the next thing through their monster investigations. But if there's more unresolved conflict, it's going to make people want to turn back to find out a resolution to what's going on. You know, like you're saying that the banshee chasing them and whatever mystery was shared isn't enough of a hook.
Right. I think that, you know, from watching a lot of pilots and shows, pretty much a TV buff. it's, you know, there's always this overarching plot or story or theme or something that overarches through the whole series, right? Or through at least through the whole season. So I think that just to have in the Banshee, I think that's a great start. And, you know, you want to have the one that got away, right? The bad guy that you did not want to try to fight today, you know, but we'll get you next time, you know, kind of thing. But you also kind of need to have something that would carry on through every episode, you know, something that people want to come back, not just for the monsters and for the fighting and stuff, but something that is more personality and character driven.
I think to pinpoint it for you would be Monk. In the Monk pilot, yeah, sure, he's OCD and his wife was killed, but it's also an ongoing unsolved murder. So there's this exterior drive that's going to push through the entire series, wondering his investigation, what happened so in this, there's no overall concern, maybe a little bit with the other monster teams, but that's sort of like fluff.
Yeah, I think there was that. And, you know, of course, there's the question of Mahisa, you know, and you know, I kind of caught that whenever she had
was it Bryce, I guess, at the time, had him turn off his comms, and then all of a sudden, poof, they were on like another side of the building or something. I didn't quite catch, but you know, there's obviously that storyline as well that he's going to start investigating her. But I kind of also almost caught sort of maybe a love interest or a possible bit of a love interest.
Sure, there should be more. There could be more of a perhaps like a forbidden romance thing. Maybe there's no romance in the team, or maybe just romance in general.
Right.
To have
right.
that sort of tone in the script that's missing too. Yeah, I can see that.
I saw it with the genie though. Like she, you know, she has that look, so I liked that little plant for that. Another show that may be good to look for reference is Librarians. I feel like that tone, you know, they're very like back and forth as the team, and I think that's an hour long. I can't be sure, but it's very, you know, magical and silly, and I feel like that's what this is kind of.
This is like Buffy, where where there isn't really like a Buffy character, like Buffy the Chosen One central character. There's more like an ensemble cast. I've never seen The Librarians. Is it like Buffy-esque?
No.
No.
So there actually is a TV show that has a direct parallel. It's called Special Unit 2. The main difference is the main characters are more like the agents from the monster organization and not actual monsters. But it plays out a lot like that, and I'm a huge fan of that show.
Special Agent 2?
Special Unit 2.
Pretty interesting. Make a note of that.
Nice. It's on. Wait, I wanted to see if I can get it free online.
Yeah, I've been waiting for it to come on Netflix for a long time. It hasn't.
So, does anybody else have any overall thoughts for Monster Investigations?
Well, I kind of wanted to elaborate there. I feel like I'm kind of the target audience for this, and I really, really enjoyed the plot. I really enjoyed the fact that action, all the action had a dialogue part to it. I feel like a lot of sci-fis miss that, where they'll just go all action and then have some tagline at the end, and that's not fun. You got to talk about what you're doing. And I really liked a lot of the way the characters developed, a lot of the ways the characters were unique, and how there was a lot of the Tick-esque characters going on. Like, Vartul wasn't dumb, but he was a little bit like the Tick.
yeah.
You have, like Doc was a lot like, not from the Tick, but a lot of shows in this exact same genre will always have that guy who's hacking things and has to figure out the mystery, and everyone's just kind of like, give it to the nerdy guy, and he'll take care of it.
Well, it's, you know, it's funny, the Doc character, because on one hand, you can call him a little bit of a caricature because he's so similar to the guy from Despicable Me, but his surfer dude attitude really skews the character in an original direction, and I think it saves the character from being a cliche. It was an interesting choice, and I like that about it.
I love that irony of the surfer dude guy that was the smart tech guy with all the gadgets.
I also like that he's Japanese. I thought that's
and that, yeah,
like a surfer Japanese guy.
I forgot he was Asian.
Anti cliche in a sense, you know.
I think something that would probably eventually unravel is that he's faking the accent. There's been a lot of shows that have done this, and it usually plays out really funny or really well. And that's kind of the impression I was getting from his character, is he's trying to act dumb so that people don't stereotype him.
Or it could just be my bad impression of a surfer dude. So, you know, take that as well.
When it said hoverboard, though, I was really expecting, like, Doc Brown or Christopher Lloyd to play him. So
yeah, you know, that's like another thing that seems almost too much of a shout-out. But then again, it makes sense. You know, like, maybe, I wonder if the script would be stronger without the hoverboard, if it was just, like, something different. I don't know.
So there was another note, and I wanted to kind of praise this, and this comes from a viewer point of view, obviously. A lot of shows of this type will make the organization work on a shoestring budget. There's always that thing that holds them back, and they can't go their full force. And this one's a bit unique. They have all the money they want, they're held back by other things, and part of it is the fact that Bryce is a little bit untrustworthy and isn't ready to, for this kind of stuff. And another part of it is that, you know, there's this running, I don't know if it's a gag, but there's this running plot line about the license.
Yeah. It's the B story, really. And it's a B story that can be increased in drama. It's a little unclear the entire time. Maybe there should be, like, another group that, like, they didn't do their license and everyone got executed or something. Like, something horrible. Like, I don't know. There could be more, the stakes of the B story could be stronger. And with what Script Chick was saying, there needs to be a conflict that would carry over in the next episode. That's part of like a third plot line.
Along the lines of that plot line, there. So I love when dialogue kind of makes me like think of humans, like real life. And I felt like, as dumb as it is, the dialogue about the license where he's like, it's in the mail, so it's official, right? And he's just kind of like, right?
Yeah.
You had the subordinate telling the leader what he wanted to hear, and
yeah,
the leader
dialogue, yeah.
And the leader's going to come back in the future. I know this is going to happen in a future episode. The leader's going to come back and be like, "You told me it was okay," and there's going to be that exchange. No, I just said what you wanted me to hear.
And then a cutaway, a one-on-one of each venting their feelings about the other guy. Exactly.
Yeah, I see that in business all the time, and it was really, really cool to see that in like in a script
turn
like this.
Sound equipment off.
I certainly enjoyed the exchange.
There we
yeah.
go.
I also like the rivalry.
Sorry about that, guys.
With the was it creature crew, the other group of monster investigators that have their reality TV show.
Yeah.
I think there could have been more.
Yeah, I agree. Like they could run into them.
No, they could have bumped into him somewhere and had a whole argument, you know?
Yeah, like Anchorman. You know, when they run into, like, their rival anchors and they have, like, a showdown fight in the park?
Yeah, they could have had another case. There could have been another case before the Ponderosa because they were looking for another case before Annalyn pulled in one. And it's like they could have showed up and the other team was there, like, wrapping it up already. Like, oh, you know,
yeah,
you snooze, you lose.
You get the
yeah.
whole the twister plot going there, where they're actually working together for a good cause, but they're rivals just because of pride.
I love that you said twister.
Yeah, there's no reason for those people to be fighting in Twister, because they're both like trying to save people, but they're like, we invented Dorothy!
Oh, Dorothy.
I just have a note on page 45 that I feel like the lead out of the act, end of act three, isn't strong enough. Like, if, because you've already established the cans falling and stuff like that, but if they could be interrupted in the middle of that prayer, then it would, you know, it'd make the audience know that something's about to happen, that they have to prep themselves for. As it is now, it's kind of like a stagnant, like, let's do this, and we've kind of already had that beat before.
Don't interrupt my prayer.
It's actually interesting you bring that up, because I really, really liked the prayer, and I too felt that after that moment, it was an awkward place for the act to end. You know, I really liked that moment. Like, the all of page 45 is really strong, and then it ends.
Yeah.
And it, yeah. Shouldn't end there, you're right.
I love Bartool. I love all his Tony Robbins stuff and just all the motivational posters in his room. Every character just had so much going for them.
What if it ended one page further down where Jane goes into the room and like she's and then it could be like she screams or something. And then it comes back and she saw like a rat and then it's like bad news and shows them the summoning cards or something.
Be good.
Yeah.
Oh, that.
I would say though that so I love Vartul, but the fact that there was a kitten poster immediately made me think of Hellboy. So I don't know if you want to stand apart from that.
Was there a kitten poster in Hellboy? Maybe there should be Hellboy posters. Like
well,
he
Hellboy.
Could,
yeah,
he could idolize Hellboy and therefore idolize the motivational shit.
Yeah, that'd be funny.
That's funny.
I mean, like, it sort of saves it, because there's already shout-outs to Hellboy multiple times.
Mm-hmm.
He might as well just be, like, a Hellboyophile reading the things. Well, Hellboy in this situation would have done this. And it's like, man, you're real. Hellboy is someone else's fantasy. Calm yourself.
I would love it if it was, if they did a photo of Hellboy, if it was the blurry one from the first movie, that would be great.
Oh, you mean like a specific...
Yeah, part of the one of the jokes in the first movie is that they're trying to prove that Hellboy exists on this TV show, and they show a picture, and it's basically blurry Bigfoot.
Okay.
And they have an argument. They're like, well, if Hellboy exists, why are all the pictures blurry? Bigfoot is blurry. That's the problem.
He is blurry.
Yeah, I'm just a big nerd and a big fan of this genre, so I'm...
I like Ron Perlman.
Nerding out over here.
Ron Perlman's the man.
I didn't know, like, if there was an intentional poltergeist joke, you know, with the bottom of page 49, they're here. But just, I think you should be a little bit more overt with that, you know, that she is mimicking the... I mean, she died in 78, but so in Poltergeist is 1982, but it seemed like you were setting it up for that, like a direct reference.
Up the numbers.
Oh, was that my line? Because if it was, I missed that.
Died in 79, movies in 82, you're all like... It's a good point.
I know my Google.
You know your shit. You know your Google.
They're here.
This character died in 79. What year did Poltergeist come out? This is bullshit.
While we're talking in technical problems here,
uh-oh.
Were vines part of the Earth Power?
I think she just like used Earth Power and made vines move, right? They were pre-existing vines.
Okay, I didn't know if that's what they're going for here, because, like, so as somebody watching the show, it's a minor thing, but as somebody who would be watching the show, like, I would be hanging on every character and waiting for these things and being like, wait, she's got vine powers now! That's awesome!
Elemental control is OP. Oh, I'm sorry, I interrupted you.
Well, no, that's a good point. I'm just remembering, like, she stopped that sign from falling outside the YMCA. I kind of wish, like, so I think one thing that might help me is that seeing them all action-y towards the later half of the script, if they were kind of working or training, like, it reminds me a little bit of X-Men. You even say Kitty Pryde, the fact that they're kind of working out or training in this YMCA. Also, the fact how they got a YMCA is because no kids work out anymore, I think. Some little joke about how they got obtained the place. Might be fun.
Agreed.
Yeah. Yeah, I like that. I like that idea. Because, I mean, they are using a YMCA, an old YMCA that's not being used anymore. So why not just go ahead and milk that a little bit?
Yeah.
Could be funny.
Also, I was waiting for a golf joke, because you established Bryce made that expensive golf app.
Yeah, he could have made, like, a bunch of golf jokes, totally.
Yeah, because that guy, it seemed like it was primed and ready for it, because the guy was super, you know, paraphernalia with all the golf stuff, and I love Vartul's line about tennis. That was super funny.
Yeah, there's a stroke of genius.
There isn't even, like, a hole-in-one, you know, joke. Like... Definitely be put in there. Which character is Bryce is the golf guy?
Bryce is the one who made the app, and then they go into the agent's office, who's obsessed with golf.
All right, the agent is obsessed.
Santiago, I think, wasn't that his name?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
The disappearing character that's there for like super briefly.
Yep.
Oh, and also in the woods, they mentioned maybe it was a deer, and I was expecting the Claire side of Annalyn's hand to, like, do something.
She could turn a deer into a statue.
Yeah, I love that my arm likes deer.
Rodney Dangerfield of level 3.
I like that line. It was kind of like, as we were reading it, it just kind of like went by. But that was really funny.
Just as a note, numbers should be spelled out in dialogue.
Yes.
I was going to say that, but I thought, I'll let Greg say it. I know he's going to point it out.
Of course I'm going to point it out. It's like one of those formatting things that I've
said. Because you pointed it out to me, and now I'd never make that mistake again.
It's like, you know, became such a formatting Nazi, and then I'm like, fuck formatting. William Goldman, Larry Ferguson for life. Never writing another interior again.
Tony asks, he says, everyone is so insightful. Are all the readers also writers? I am.
Yes.
I am not a good writer, but yes.
Affirmative.
I write RPGs.
You write RPGs?
Yeah.
You want to read my manual for an RPG that I created that my entire gaming group plays in now?
Yeah, that's awesome. I love homebrew.
I'm probably the only one that's actually not a writer, but I play one on TV, so that's important.
No, we've seen you playing with your Scrivener.
I want to run a campaign on this, because we have talk and we have this chat. I want to play a game. No maps or anything, but we'd have to use something for dice rolling.
Are you talking about making this script into a game?
No, I'm talking about just in general playing an RPG on the Discord.
Oh, you could do it through Roll 20.
I didn't even know how to write that. How did you guys do that?
How did we do what?
I wanted to join in on the little chat window, and I don't know where to type.
Oh. Are you logged into Twitch right now?
Yes.
When you're on Vince's... You've got Vince's stream up, so you can see him?
Yes. Is it here on the right corner?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Right.
Where it says send a message.
Show chat.
Yeah, it shows a, it shows me, like, I typed right corner, but I don't see it popping up on the main thing.
Did you press enter?
Yeah.
Can you see other people's chat in the chat window on the right?
No, that's the thing. I can see it on the main, on the actual video, but not on the right.
Are you full screened? Maybe that's why.
ID full screened. And it says no group chat, so that's probably why, but
okay, so in your browser where you're watching Twitch and you're seeing Vince's face, in the top right corner you should see a little tiny arrow that's pointing to the left, and if you click on that arrow, it should slide to the left a chat window.
Now, I think I see what she says. She says that she sees, you see a box that says all chat rooms. You see channel chat, group chats, pending invitation. Is that what you see?
Yes. Yeah, I see that.
At the very top of that box, you see Vince's name, right? And to the left, you see what looks like kind of like a bar graph. It's a horizontal bar graph.
Yes.
Okay, click that.
Yeah, and it says, welcome to the chat room, now hosting Vincenzo Marola.
Great.
Oh, that's why, because she's on her own account.
Yep.
So where you see mine, where mine is, just click my name.
He tricked you.
After you went back to your channel to host, you stayed there. So you were watching Vince through your channel because you're hosting it right now. But you can't
there
chat
she is.
With us unless
there
you come.
I am.
There you are.
Playing host to all these tricks.
Trixie devils. Okay, cool. Yay, I'll contribute.
So you
more.
Didn't see anything awesome. That we were typing in the chat room the entire time?
I saw it, but it's like I'm like a fucking mute over here because I don't know how to
learn. I figured you didn't know. Yeah, but at least you could see what we were saying.
Everyone was like giving you props, like bot's killing it. Oh shit.
Cool, now I know the nets.
Yeah, Script Check is a really welcome addition to our table readers group because it's been only me and Erica as the female voices.
Yes.
So a lot of times we get like 7 roles each and stuff like that, or we'd have to talk to ourselves in a conversation. So thanks for doing this, Grip Chick, and I hope that, you know, you can make it to some more table reads in the future. It's been great to have you.
Yeah, it's super fun.
And your Indian accent was on point.
On point.
Perfect.
Spot on.
Perfect, though.
That and you had to do it as a valley girl.
Yeah, that was...
That's so funny. I'm so jealous of you guys because you can do all these accents. And I saw I had 2 main roles, and I'm Jane, who's like normal. And then Annalyn, and I'm like, oh my God, I cannot do a different voice. And the only thing I could think of was, well, maybe if I lowered my voice like really low and it would surprise everybody.
I was like, I almost peed my pants laughing every time you did your lines.
Yes.
Yeah.
Same here. As a matter of fact,
Brown been on? Was she on some TV show, right?
The name is familiar, but I didn't even look into it. I was just like, oh man, how am I going to sound like a full-figured black lady that's also the bride of Frankenstein? Yeah, so I used inspiration from Brickleberry. I don't know if any of you guys have seen that cartoon, but there's this one female character on there, and it's animated, but the female... Her name is Connie, but her voice is super low like that, and she's played by a guy, and I just thought that was hilarious. So I was channeling her. Yeah, for Annalyn, I was trying to sound like Connie.
You sounded just like Meg Ryan's character when she played the sister in Joe versus the Volcano.
I'm going to have to rewatch that because I haven't seen Joe versus... I haven't watched that in so long, I don't remember it.
You can probably YouTube it.
Oh, I know, I can
find
it.
Get that character's accent.
I'll check it out.
I think this is going to go down as like one of the best table reads that we've had. I mean, everyone's accent and everything tonight was so on point tonight.
I agree. Yes. It's hard to top this.
Been off with Doc. I'd love to see Doc and Rick from Rick and Morty. Like,
okay, I was channeling a little bit of. Is Rick the grandpa or Morty? Yeah, Rick, right?
Rick is the grandpa. Rick,
yeah.
Rick,
so with my burping, I was trying to channel a little bit of Rick. Rick and Connie together.
Your voice was a gas.
I'm excited to have Script Chick read one of the female parts in my other scripts. Like, I've got I'm glad that we've got this girl, because the script that I just wrote has 3 main female characters. I was like, oh man, no matter what we do, someone's going to speak to themselves.
Mm-hmm.
Now we have 3.
I mean, we might even have 2 more. You never know.
That's too many.
to hell with those other girls.
I mean, not a problem if you're schizophrenic. I mean,
right.
Roses are red, violets are blue. I'm a schizophrenic, and so on.
That's a good one.
Now all the female roles are going to get way more complicated, and it's just going to drive her away. That's just what's going to happen.
Probably.
Also, Pee-wee, your clown had me rolling too with laughter.
That was really funny.
I do an Uncle Grandpa impression, and I'm like, if I just make it high pitched, I can do the clown. That'll be great. Yeah, I struggled with Reggie, though. I was like, I have no idea what I'm going to do. So I tried to do Morgan Freeman, and it just came out awful.
The clown, like, when I finally heard, like, a line of it, it reminded me of, what was it, in Wreck-It Ralph. You know,
yeah.
I was like, what's so fun? Like, that guy. That guy, I like how you played that.
Thank you.
Oh, this is a tiny note for, was it Frankie Lance?
Yeah,
thank you, Hollywood. Lance,
I didn't get why you needed the heights in the description, except for the goblins and Vartul to kind of show that they're imposing or diminutive. But everyone else, it's like
totally unnecessary.
Yeah.
Good point. I was actually thinking that,
but
I think forgot it. I think he just kept it as like he started having heights for one character and then realized he needed them for another and then just threw them all in there, you know? Like, when is it necessary for this 7-foot orc for anyone who's abnormally tall or abnormally short, throw in the height, you know?
I can actually go either way on it. I mean, I think I've sort of been taught, like, you don't need to go into that kind of detail about people, because then when you get to casting, like, you're handcuffing yourself to, or you're restricting yourself more than you need to, and it should be more open and flexible, but...
Right, so like, instead of using the numbers, say, a tall demon, like, 7 feet,
right,
towering and...
Goblinese. Yes, it was Goblinese.
Yeah. But, like, you know, I was reading... Sorry, I was going to say something real quick. I was reading this other script this morning, and that writer also was using heights for every character, which normally I would complain about, except in this script, it was like I could visualize every person, and I felt like he was visualizing them, like he knew what every single person looked like. So I don't know why, like, sometimes it doesn't bother me, and sometimes it does, but...
I can make a suggestion. Since this script is sort of like office-like, what if every single character intro was a superimposed insert that was over the screen? Bryce Barnes, 26, 5'7". You know, like, thin nerd of the group. Like, super.
I like the idea of the supers, but I think sounds weird to put the height.
Well, it would be like an
especially
intro
if you're
card.
Seeing them visually.
Right, it would be like a little intro card printed out, member of the team, Bryce Barnes, shows a little picture, 26, has 5'7", next to, like, a little overview with some computer graphics, you know?
Yeah,
a little
yeah.
Blur, maybe, like, a quote, like, give each character a quote, like, blah, blah.
Yep, the little Monsters Investigations logo spinning in the bottom left corner.
Exactly. Like, fancy up. Dress it up. Take the height. And then put a tuxedo on it and put it right there in front.
I'm picking up what you're putting down.
I like the tuxedo.
Well, yeah. You know that. I always feel so dressed down, but then again, I'm not on camera.
Making me want to put my suit on.
Oh, yeah. Is page 17 is a knob? It just makes me wonder if the writer's British. Because I only hear that with British speak.
What? Where?
No, I live in Canada, and we say knob all the time.
Yeah?
Like, fuck you. Yeah, like, you fucking knob. We always say knob.
Yeah, you knob.
Page 17.
There were also some spelling items in there, too, that I noticed where an S would normally... Well,
wait.
I shouldn't say normally. Would be used in American, it would be a Z. But in the UK, it would be an S. And I think there was an OU, I can't remember, but yeah, so I get what she's saying. I think it sounds like the writer is British.
I don't know if he's British. He lives in Oregon, I know that much.
Huh.
Well, that's close to Canada, so that would
we are both in the Pacific Northwest.
But polishing one's knob is like a regular colloquialism. I don't think it's necessarily British.
Yeah. I've heard polish.
Like, if you call it, it's like, you knob, you know, like, oh, man, all right.
I guess I'm dirtier. Never.
You know, then again, it could just be a character choice. I mean, we do live in the modern age. People know, like, British English.
Mm-hmm.
True, yeah. And Annalyn's been dead for a while, so, you know, who knows what she picks up.
Yeah.
I just wish I'm sorry, I thought you were...
No, I'm done.
That kind of Oregon trailed off.
That's Pee Wee the Punster, everybody.
Thanks, Pee Wee.
Mad scientist.
Okay.
So we're in agreement. The script needs an extra plot line of contention.
Yes, we agree with whatever you
yeah.
said, Greg. Whatever you say. So yeah, no, I thought that was a really good table read.
I loved it. I really enjoyed it. Sorry for messing up a few times. Actually, I was going to say that one of the times that I messed up, it was because of you, Smish, when you were reading as Anna and Elise. I can't remember the name.
Annalyn.
I don't, for some reason, your voice that you were using for some reason just completely combined with mine,
and it just really messed me up. I mean, because that's the reason why I started reading, and I just completely lost it and just had to finish in my normal voice, just because, for whatever reason, I could hear your voice, and it was coming out completely, completely wrong.
I did have a little bit of a stoner inflection in there. But that's just kind of me, you know?
But no, I think overall, I enjoyed it. I loved it. I thought it was really good. It's very entertaining. I thought very funny. I would like to see him write a second one for an episode two.
What a waste of time. He's got to write a Bible, outline a few episodes, outline every character. There's no way he should spend his time writing another script.
Okay, or whatever it is that – yeah, whatever it is that you need to do, I guess, for a pilot. I don't know what it is, but to carry it forward, right, whether that's a Bible or an outline for a full season, I don't know what that is. But I want to see more, I guess, is what I'm trying to get at.
Well, when you submit TV pilots, typically you submit the Bible. What a Bible is going to have – is it'll have a breakdown of every single character, a synopsis of the episode, the log line. It'll have some info about the world that it's taking place in, some background, some info on the style, the tone, right? And then you need to have a breakdown, if it's serialized, you need to have a breakdown of every episode in the first season. It could be short, but like it has to explain what happens in each episode, roughly. If it's something like this, which is more like procedural, then what you'd have is like a paragraph or two, and have like four or five pitches for future episodes. Each pitch like a paragraph or so. And in this episode, there could be this going on, and their struggle is this. This character has conflict with that over this, you know, et cetera. On Blacklist, when people submit. Submit pilots. Typically, it's suggested every pilot should have a Bible along with it. You know, and this is the third pilot that I've read by Frankie. I don't know if he's made any Bibles, but I'll certainly say this: this pilot is much better than his other two. I mean, I know Nightmare is getting some positivity, and yeah, it was a good read. And I read one of his other ones, and it was kind of weaker than Nightmare. And this one, I think, is stronger than Nightmare. I think this is his strongest work thus far, which is good because you write more, you get better. He's developing his style. Mm-hmm. Like I can see his writing tone mm-hmm. in what he's doing with the dialogue. The dialogue he's a lot stronger in dialogue than he is in the prose. The prose is a little weak. Like he has some hanging sentences, words like repetitive over and over a couple times. But I don't know how late this is a draft. I think he's pushing this out as much as he can to get ready for the tournament, right?
That's one thing I wanted to point out, is that this is actually his first draft.
Right, yeah. So, you know, he's going to get some notes from this. He'll be able to go back. When you work on a draft like that, you just throw the action lines out there because it's less the poetry of each prose as it is the specific of what each character is doing and what's going on. I had a bad habit where when I'd write a first draft, I'd capitalize every character name all the time, so I was able to easily see where characters were and make sure that I was including them, you know? I say a bad habit because it kind of looked ugly and it took a lot of work to get rid of it all. But for a first draft, I mean, it's unfair to say, oh, someone first draft, because what does really first draft mean? Some people write from specific outlines. Other people write a vomit draft and then choose story things later. I feel like the story had to have been outlined ahead of time. And but with a script like this, by the time you're actually sitting down to write the story, every character is so complex. You know, he took the majority of the time figuring out who the characters are, what their dynamic is, what their attitudes are, how they interact, you know, and then once they get filled into the plot, like a role-playing game, it falls together and the character interaction is what drives the story forward itself.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, the fact that he's got such great character work and also really strong dialogue, it's definitely effective. The story is effective. Yeah, it has, like, you know, like we were saying, it needs a little bit more in terms of like the overall season arc adding like that drama. Maybe if there's an addressing the tonal shift, part one, part two thing, some extra jokes. But otherwise, this is a really strong script. It's good.
All right. Well, I think on that note, we're gonna cut it. Let me go ahead and snip the recording button off.